Welcome back to Trinity Project. My name is Evan, and we are continuing our discussion about the topic salvation in the part two. That will be the Feast of the Lord, or the Hebrew calendar. And the reason why I'm naming the Hebrew calendar, because those people who were living in those days were Hebrews, they were not Jews. So, now you've been baptized, you've been saved, and you were born again, and you should start to live new life. If you're saved by grace through faith, that doesn't mean that you should go back and live your old life. So what are you supposed to do? Well, according to the Bible and according to the prophets and apostles and how they were living, you're supposed to do three things. You should pray, you should fast, and you should do a communion. How you should learn to pray? Well, the best example is the book of Psalms. When you go into the book of Psalms, you will learn not how to pray, but when to pray. So you should always have a morning prayer. You should have also an evening prayer. You should pray over your food as a Thanksgiving, and you should pray every time when you want to say, when you need support, or you want to say thank you, God, for something that you've that he bless you with something. Next thing is fasting. So fasting, you should, if we see the standard model of fasting, is no water, no food. But that is kind of like hard for our modern day society. So, I mean, I'm not saying that you should not try to practice that, but if you start to do that immediately, you're gonna shock your body. So I'll suggest you, first of all, to start with fasting, like drinking light liquids and eating fruits and vegetables. Then you can go on the second level, which I'm practicing, and that will be on the liquids, by drinking water, tea, or coffee. And then when you overcome that, you can go and try to fast with no water and no food. And also, when you look in the Bible, you will see that there's a specific times when you will have to fast, and there's a time when you need to fast, when you feel that you want to fast because you do something wrong, or you want to say thank you, God. And the third thing is the communion, or the Lord's Supper, which you can do by drinking a wine, which is representing the blood of Jesus, and eating a bread, unleavened bread, which is representing the body of Christ. And the best example of that you can find in the Gospels, in the chapters where it's talking about, when Jesus is talking about the Last Supper. So now let's go back to the main topic about the Hebrew calendar. So before we start, I want to give a short introduction first to our modern day holidays like Easter and Christmas. So I'm going to read really quick. When Rome occupied Egypt, the Romans became acquainted with a new way of calculating time, and Julius decided to introduce him to Rome, but with greater accuracy to connect the sunny year with the Europe, that is, the sun with European spring, summer, etc. By the order of Julius Caesar, the mathematician of Alexandria, created a Roman calendar called Julianus. Thus, it was introduced into the Roman Empire on January 1st, 46 BC, with which the year began on January 1st. Then we have the Gregorian calendar, and the Gregorian calendar is a calendar used today in Europe for former European colonies as well as most of the world. It is a modification of the Julian calendar, and the first proposed by Neapolitan Dr. Alosius Lilly, I'm not sure if I'm pronouncing it correctly, and was accepted by the decree of Pope Gregory XIII, by whom he was called. So now we're going to go further more, and I'm going to play you a video from the YouTube channel Neftali 1981, where he's going to give the history and the background of Easter and Christmas.
The male reproductive organ of Nimrod. His private parts, yes, his private parts. And it's called the obelisk. This is the same obelisk that is in front of Washington, D.C. Can you believe that? Pretty sick, ain't it? It's the same one in front of the Catholic Church. They don't just have his male reproductive organ. They have a sun wheel around it. You see, the nations of this world, they've stopped worshiping the true creator, God himself, Jesus Christ, in favor of worshiping idols of male reproductive organs. That alone should let you know how sick they are. But anyhow, off topic, let's keep on going. Semiramis basically said that he went up to the sun and one of his sun rays hit her in her reproductive part, you know, her female section. And what happened then is she claims that she got pregnant and that she was the fulfillment of the prophecy of Genesis 3:15. You see, Noah was bringing across all of them teachings. Noah was continuously talking all of the things that he knew about and spreading and getting people to follow God and all of that stuff. And she wanted to claim that she was that fulfillment, that she was that mother with child. So she had a son. His name is Tammuz. And guess where Tammuz was born? Tammuz was born on approximately between December 21st and December 25th, approximately. Now, the thing is this, they would celebrate his birthday on December the 25th. So eventually, she passed on, and when she passed on, idols started becoming in her name. And one of the idols that started becoming in her name, there's a story that she basically actually went up to the moon, to the sun, to the planets, and basically she came down to earth as a voluptuous goddess in a giant egg. And that this egg landed in the Euphrates River, and basically, I'm getting ahead of myself, but basically, occult rituals happen in the name of that, called Easter, Ishtar. My friends, when you really start studying this stuff, you're going to find out that there's a corrupt system out there, replacing what God truly had intended for his church. Sun worship was rampant in those times. You see, Satan didn't care what people worshipped. He just wanted people to worship things other than God. And sun worship was very prevalent, and you can find it in the scriptures. Why am I speaking on this? Because this is going to show you and lead you into understanding what corrupt system there is out there right now. In 2 Kings 23:5, look what God says. And he put down the idolatrous priest, whom the kings of Judah had ordained to burn incense in the high places in the cities of Judah. And in the places round about Jerusalem, them also that burn incense unto Baal, to the sun, and to the moon, and to the planet, and to all the host of heaven. So you see, there were people honoring the sun, honoring the moon, honoring the planets, which God clearly condemns to do. Furthermore, open up your scriptures. This is in your word of God. In Ezekiel 8:13 through 18. He said also unto me, turn thee yet again, and thou shalt see greater abominations that they do. Then he brought me to the door of the gate of the Lord's house, which was towards the north, and behold, there sat women weeping for Tammuz. We already discussed who Tammuz was. Horus, in secular history, Tammuz is the son of Isis. You're finding this in the scriptures. And they were weeping for Tammuz. We can go into the story as to why they were weeping, but that'll just off-track us, so we'll just keep on going. Then he said unto me, hast thou seen this, O son of man? Turn thee yet again, and thou shalt see greater abominations than these. And he brought me into the inner courts of the Lord's house, and behold, at the door of the temple of the Lord, between the porch and the altar, were about 25 men with their backs toward the temple of the Lord, with their faces toward the east, and they worshiped the sun towards the east. We're talking about a wicked, wicked generation. We're talking about wicked men in the house of the Lord doing these sorts of wicked things.
Okay, guys, I hope you realize the history and the background of the modern day pagan holidays. Now let's go back and give you a short introduction about the biblical calendar. So the Bible's calendar is precisely the calendar that is mentioned for the first time in the five books of Moses, also known as the Law, where it is precisely stated when it is the beginning of the year, which is the first month, and which are the main holidays throughout the year. According to this calendar, the first month of the year is April, Nisan, also known as Nisan, and the last month is March, also known as Adar. The calendar refers to the symbolic meaning of the years of Enoch, which is 365, but according to the book of Enoch are 364 days. And there's a reason why is that, because of the calculations. And it's in a full synchronization with the sun and the moon. So now I'm gonna show you another short video clip from the YouTube channel Robert Clancy, where you can see the details about the Feast of the Lord.
It was on top of Mount Sinai that God gave Moses the dates and observances of the seven feasts of the Lord, which are Passover, Unleavened Bread, First Fruits, Pentecost, Trumpets, Atonements, and then the Feast of Tabernacles. It is interesting to note that the Hebrew word for feast is moed, which more literally translated means divine appointments. And more importantly, all seven feasts point to and are fulfilled in Jesus. These feasts are separated into two seasons, the spring feasts and the fall feasts. Jesus was crucified on Passover. He was then buried on the Feast of Unleavened Bread and resurrected on the Feast of First Fruits 50 days later. The Holy Spirit was given to us on Pentecost. Now, the entire human race exists between the feasts of the spring and fall, which represent the church age. The Lord is harvesting believers and patiently beckoning those who will follow him until the fall feasts come. These fall feasts are to be fulfilled in the second coming of Jesus. And the first of these is the Feast of Trumpets. And this represents, I believe, the rapture of the church. While the Feast of Atonement represents the second coming, and the Feast of Tabernacles represents the kingdom age of the Lord, we want to celebrate as a church the Feast of Trumpets. Jesus himself said, "Behold, I am coming quickly." And we look forward to that day and welcome the return of our Lord.
Okay, now that we have the full understanding of the calendar, let's go back in Exodus 23. Verse 10 through 19, where God is telling us which feast that we should hold before the second coming of Jesus Christ. And I'm going to read just the first part. For 6 years, you are to sow your land and gather in its produce. But in the seventh year, you must let it lie fallow and leave it alone, so that the poor of your people may eat, and what they leave, any animal in the field may eat. You must do likewise with your vineyard and you and your olive grove. For 6 days you are to do your work, but on the seventh day you must cease, in order that your ox and your donkey may rest, and that your female servant's son and any hired help may refresh themselves. Pay attention to do everything I have told you, and do not even mention the names of the gods. Do not let them be heard on your lips. You can continue on through the verse 19. I just want to read you the first part of the scripture. And now I'm going to go and read you more details. Basically, we're going to go back to the beginning. So, we have the tradition of man confirmed by the religion, which is once again Happy New Year, Valentine's Day, Easter, Thanksgiving, and Merry Christmas. I'm going to stick to Easter and Merry Christmas. I mean, I'm going to show, I want to prove you why Easter and Christmas are so dangerous, because this is way beyond man traditions. This is the doctrine of devils and fallen angels. And also I show you the original feasts of the Lord, which are once again the spring feasts, Passover, unleavened bread, first fruits, Pentecost, and the fall feasts, trumpets, atonement, and tabernacles. We should celebrate the spring feasts, which is Passover, the death, unleavened bread, the burial, first fruits, the resurrection, and Pentecost, spirit of Elohim, or the Holy Spirit. You can find also Bible verses about Passover in Exodus, Matthew, in Exodus 12, Matthew 26, Leviticus 23, in John 18, in 1 Corinthians about unleavened bread, in Leviticus 23 again, in John 6, and in Acts 2 about the first fruits in Leviticus 23, Deuteronomy 26, 1 Corinthians 15, and James 1. This is the resurrection. And Pentecost, Leviticus 23, 15, Deuteronomy 16, and Acts chapter 1 and 2, which is talking about the spirit of Elohim. The whole calendar you have in Leviticus 23, you have the whole details about the calendar. And this is, and if you want to know more about the calendar and how I've done the whole calculation and how you should celebrate all of these feasts, feel free to add me on Facebook. You have the link of the account on my YouTube channel, and also I'm going to leave all of the materials in the description box below. Okay, guys, so thanks again for watching, and God bless all of you. See you next time. Bye-bye.